I can start whenever you want.
ओके ओके गुड मॉर्निंग, हाउ आर यू सर? या गुड,
Yeah, I'm doing good. Dr. Sarika, how are you?
ऑल गुड. सो टुडे फुल डे योर्स,
Yeah, I mean, okay. So
किना
I'm talking for only this session,
मेना
but yeah, my students will be talking about
या
their
एनी
work in the next two sessions, I think.
या एनीवेज दे रिप्रेजेंट यू एंड IIITD.
Right. Yeah. I don't know if it's me, yeah, but definitely to create a delivery team.
ओके, सो जस्ट लेट अस वेट फॉर 1 मिनट और 2 मिनट्स एंड वील गो एट देन.
Sure. So I have a question. So are the participants same as the ones for the earlier FTP, or are they
Yeah,
different?
not exactly. Probably
Okay.
probably 10% overlap.
Okay, so there's less overlap. Okay, sure.
Yeah, otherwise the participants who might be interested, I have already shared the previous links to them.
Okay,
So if
sure.
they,
Yeah, thanks.
and though I have told from my side that that is a prerequisite, you must go through those links, but maybe most of them have really gone through them.
Okay, sure. So in between my talk, I'll give a brief recap.
That will be so nice.
Okay, yeah, sure.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, आई होप वी शुड इनिशिएट इट टू सम एक्सटेंट नाउ. बाय द टाइम इट विल सेट द पेस.
Sure. So shall I get started?
जस्ट अलाउ मी फॉर अ ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन.
Sure. Okay, sure.
या यू कुड शेयर योर स्क्रीन बाय फॉर द टाइम बीइंग इफ यू विश सो. सो डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, या ओके सर, या
Okay.
या ओके, योर वेबएक्स स्क्रीन इज देयर, राइट?
True.
या ट्रू. सो डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स, वी हैव राइट नाउ डॉक्टर राघवा मुथराजू विद अस, एंड ही हैज ऑलरेडी स्पोकन ऑन आवर वर्कशॉप्स ऑफ सिमेंटिक इंटेलिजेंस फॉर द लास्ट टू वर्कशॉप्स आल्सो. सो यू कुड लुक एट हिज प्रीवियस वीडियोस ऑन द यूट्यूब चैनल. आई विल शेयर द लिंक्स विद यू. दिस प्रोफेसर इज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन द कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ IIIT दिल्ली. ही गॉट हिज PhD इन कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग फ्रॉम राइट स्टेट यूनिवर्सिटी डेटन USA इन 2016. ही हैज वर्कड इन इंडस्ट्री रिसर्च लैब्स सच एज GE रिसर्च, IBM रिसर्च, बेल लैब्स एंड जेरोक्स रिसर्च. हिज रिसर्च इंटरेस्ट आर इन वेरियस एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ सीमेंटिक वेब सच एज नॉलेज ग्राफ्स, ontology modeling, reasoning, querying, and also its applications to specific domains. He is also interested in big data applications. He has published at various venues like CERN, ISWC, ESWC, WISE, and also organized or co-organized workshops at these conferences majorly. ISWC, WWW website, majorly the semantic web conferences and also certain tutorials. He has been on the program committee of various semantic web conferences also. I can see the major flagship conferences in his list. So welcome to you, sir. Thank you very much. And over to you, sir.
Great, great. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sarkar. And happy to be here again. Thank you for the invitation. And I hope all the participants will have a good time at this workshop. So, okay. So thank you for the introduction as well. So let me also briefly introduce this session and the next two sessions, right? And also the group. So this is our research group. I put the link in the chat. So apart from the work that I'll be discussing now, there are other projects as well that are going on. And if you can browse through the group pages to get to know more about the projects and the people that I'm working with. Right? Okay. Okay. So in this session, I'll be talking about explainability, right? And how semantics can play a role in explainability. So that's the first session. And the next two sessions will also be related to semantics and knowledge graphs in general, right? And that's, and three of my students, PhD students, they'll be talking about different aspects of it. Let's say knowledge graph embeddings and reasoning and ontologies and ontology learning. How do you extract these concepts and relations from texts and so on. So that's about the next two sessions. But in this session, I'll be talking about the explainability aspect. And as we go along, so this is a very high level overview of explainability, right? So please feel free to stop me at any time so you can unmute and ask questions. And while I go along, I can pause and then also answer questions. So so I have only one device, so I'll not be looking at the chat while I talk, but I can take a pause and then take a look at the chat. So if you have any questions, you can also post on the chat and I can answer them, let's say after 10-15 minutes, right? Okay, so with that, I'll get started. I'll briefly talk about what explainability is and then what do I mean by semantics. That's the second part. And in the third part, I'll discuss an application which makes use of these semantics to generate the explanations. Right? So that's broadly the three pieces in my talk. And at some point in the talk, I'll also give a demo. Right? So right after the explanation, just to discuss more about this explanation, what explanation is and how it's generated and all. At least from one application point of view, I'll be giving two demos. Right? So that's broadly the overview of the talk. Okay, so let me get started with the first part, which is an overview of explanations and explainability. Okay, you would, I think you would by now have you'd be very familiar with these things, right? So machines and artificial AI algorithms, they are playing a key role in several domains, right? So whenever you browse or come across any application, there's a high chance that they're making use of some AI algorithm in the background. So for example, when you go over the Amazon website, so you search for something, but right and somewhere on the screen, it will also show you the recommendations. So it will say these are the things that other users have purchased, or these are things that are related to whatever we are searching for. So for example, if you are searching for a television TV, then maybe they'll show the television stands as well. That these are the things that you can purchase along with the TVs, right? So these are some of the recommendations. And it also happens if you're watching movies on Netflix or Prime. Let's say you have watched a few movies and then there'll be recommendations. based on whatever you have already watched and based on your likes. So it can compute the likes and dislikes. Sometimes it's also asked explicitly, right? So you can give the feedback on a particular movie. So based on these things, it can recommend a few more movies. And so on and so forth. So you can, these things are, so even in the finance sector, for example, you have applied for a loan at a bank. And so there'll be some processing that will go on. And at the end, they'll say whether it's, whether they can give you the loan and how much. So let's say if you have asked for X amount, maybe they'll reduce that. And then they'll say, maybe this is how much that we can offer. Or they can say, okay, they can, they'll maybe reject the loan application. So these are, and again, there is some processing that is going on at the background, which can potentially involve AI algorithms. So machines are helping humans in making these decisions in various domains. Some of them might be critical. So in the sense that it will affect the lives of human beings, that could be some of the healthcare applications, or it can affect us financially, right? Like in the case of these loan applications. So there are critical decisions that machines are involved in, and there are not so critical decisions. Let's say if in the movie recommendation part, right? Let's say if instead of recommending X movie, if it recommends Y movie, which you don't necessarily like, then it's still okay. You may watch part of the movie and then decide that, okay, this is not for you, right? But which is not so critical. But there are other decisions which are more critical, and it might impact, or it might lead to a loss of either wealth or life or something else. So in those kinds of, especially in those kinds of decisions, you would want to develop some kind of trust over the recommendations that the machine is giving out. So then the next question is, how do you trust these decisions, right? So let's say machine gives out, the AI algorithm gives out a decision that some kind of drug should be given to a patient, but it may not necessarily be the correct decision. Or in order to trust that decision, you need to know why the machine has, or the algorithm has proposed that drug, right? Or that drug, or that that made that decision. So in order to know that, the machine should be able to explain its decision. So that's where this explainability comes in. So the other aspect is this, the ethical aspect, which has become popular in the past few years. So for example, there is this couple of famous events that have happened over the search and AI algorithms. Let's say there was some search related to an African-American, and it turned out that the algorithm said it's a monkey, that human is a monkey, because it's not part of the training algorithm, training data, right? So there's not sufficient training data related to, let's say, a particular group of people. So that's why it could not recognize that person well. And there were other similar events that have happened in the past. So it's always important to know, the at least in these kinds of scenarios, why the machine has recommended something. So that's where the motivation for the explanations comes in. So if the machine can explain its decision on why it has recommended something, then that will improve the trust on that particular decision. Because most likely, eventually, the decision would be approved by a human. Right? So if the human can see the explanation and then get convinced, then there's a higher chance that the human can trust the decision that was given out by the machine. So I'm using machine and AI algorithm interchangeably here. Right? So I mean both the same, at least in this talk. Okay, so due to these reasons, the field of explainable AI, or XAI for short, that has gained a lot of prominence in the past few years. And we'll also later on, we'll see this graph where I talk about this historical perspective, right? Where the graph has taken off in the past few years. So that's why we need these explanations. And now like I said, we'll learn more about the sustainability in the next an hour or so. Okay, so what is explainability? Although it's very intuitive, there is no formal agreement as such on what explainability is. So we rely on the dictionary meaning, which is this is the dictionary meaning from the Oxford English Dictionary. So I have taken the whatever was mentioned in the dictionary, right? And this is sufficient to capture the meaning of it. So if the machine can explain the reasons for the action that it has taken, so action in this case could be the recommendation that it has given out. Then, or it could be, let's say, in the case of automated driverless cars, right? So it needs to take a decision every instant. So there are vehicles on the street, and if there's a traffic light, then it has to respond. It has to respond to the honking sounds and the constantly changing state of the traffic, right? So it has to take decisions constantly, and even there, an explanation would be good. Let's say if it has decided not to stop at a traffic light, and later on to get to know the system more or better, it needs to have an explanation. So if it can give out this rationale for the decision taken, then that's what explainability in our case is. Okay, let me pause briefly. I have heard some sound. Okay, so this is not related to. So that's about the definition or the meaning of explainability, right? So let's briefly look at the principles of explainable AI. So there are broadly four principles. One is the explanation meaningfulness, and then the accuracy of the explanation, and the last one is the knowledge limits. So in most of my slides, I have this link at the bottom of it. Later on, if need be, I can share if there is interest, I can share the slides, and you can click in order to know more about the particular topic in the slide or the content in the slide. You can go back and read these papers. So mostly they are papers, research papers, and you can give it a read later on. So this was so the material in this particular talk, it's compiled from a few papers. And like I said, I give the link at the bottom of the slide. Okay, so let's start with the first one. So if you say that a particular system is explainable or it's an explainable AI system, then the very first requirement should obviously be that it should be able to generate some explanation. Right? The explanation can be in any form. Let's say it can put out the explanation in the form of a few words, or it can, let's say, if it's a machine learning kind of classification system, right? Then it can maybe put out the features, the top, let's say, n features that it has used to arrive at the decision. Or it can put out some sort of symbols or, say, parts of the image. So let's say if it's an image classification system, you are putting in, the input would be something like a bird. So now you need to detect whether there's a bird in the image or not. So the explanation in this case could be part of the image where there is a bird or part of the bird, right? So explanations can be in many forms, but if the system can generate some sort of explanation, then that can be categorized as an explainable AI system, or that's one of the principles. The second one is the meaningfulness. So whatever the explanation that was put out, that needs to be meaningful. Right, that's pretty intuitive, right? Let's say if it has put out some explanation, it doesn't make any sense. The user cannot go over the explanation, and if the user cannot make any sense of the explanation, then it's not helpful at all. Even though the system generated some explanation, it is not meaningful. Right, so second principle needs to be, it needs the explanation that is put out by the system has to have some meaning. So, okay, the amount of, even this is relative, right? So it could be very meaningful, or it may not be, it might be only slightly be meaningful, but so that is part of the, that is up to the system. So, but it needs to make sense in some way at least. So that's the second principle. And the third principle is the accuracy part. So so this accuracy is different from the accuracy of the decision kind of decision making accuracy of the system. So let's say going back to this bird classification example, let's say you have given the input of I don't know, a dog, for example, and it has the system has categorized that to be a kind of bird, which is not accurate, right? So that's so the accuracy, the decision accuracy in this case comes down by quite a bit. But let's say if you have given a bird and it has indeed, let's say you have given the image of a parrot and it was able to successfully say that it is indeed either a parrot or a bird, then the accuracy is high. So that is different. But the accuracy here, what we mean is the accuracy of the explanation, right? So if the explanation is accurate, so what does that mean? So so let's say you have used certain algorithms or certain techniques to or the AI algorithm has used a few techniques to give out the explanation, sorry, not to give out the decision. In this case, it's a bird, right? So if the AI algorithm has given out this decision, then the explanation should also be as close as possible to the decision that has been taken. So for example, let's say it has used features like the shape of the nose, shape of the mouth, and the amount of whether there is fur on the body or not. So these are some of the features, right? And the number of limbs that it has, whether it has feathers or not. So these are, these could be some of the features in identifying the picture or the entity in the picture. Even the explanation should be close to that. So if there is, if it is pretty close to that, then the accuracy is high. Let's say the image is that of a bird, but you have in the explanation it has given out that the color of the background is green. It is not very accurate, right? So, so, and that's also what we mean by fidelity. So, if it is closer to the techniques that were used in generating the, let's say, the classification decision, then the explanation should also be, if it's, if the explanation is also close to it, then it's highly accurate, right? If it's not close, then it's not so accurate, and then the fidelity is an alternative term, right? So the fidelity is also high. Okay, so that's about the explanation accuracy. And the last one is knowledge limits. So this is very similar to the humans, so what we do. So let's say if I don't have any knowledge regarding, say, the solar system, and if there are questions related to that, then I would have to say that I don't know, right? Or the confidence in my answer is very low. So that's what, if the system can also do that, then that will be good. Let's say you have trained the system on cats, cat images. But if you have fed in a dog image, then it should be able to say that either it has not been trained in that domain, or the confidence of its answer is less. So let's say it's able to say that it's not a cat, or I don't know, let's say if we go one level deeper, let's say it has to say what kind of breed of the animal it is. Let's say it's a cat, but there are, let's say, certain breeds in the cat, and it should be able to give that breed also as part of the decision, right? So if it can say that with very low confidence, let's say the confidence is only 10 out of 100. So that's also some sort of explanation for the answer that has been given out. So it should know the limits of the knowledge that it has. And that's the fourth principle. So these are broadly the four principles of explainable AI systems. Okay, so let me take a pause there, and I can, okay, I'll check the chat, but if you have any questions, I can take them and then we can move on. So you can post your questions either in the chat, or you can unmute and ask. Okay, sure. Yeah, I'll go over the knowledge limit. So the knowledge limit part, it's very similar to like I said, what humans do, right? Let's say I have some knowledge related to, let's say, explainable AI and say knowledge representation. But let's say if there is a question related to philosophy or politics, right? I might not be able to answer it well, or I might be able to answer it, but not, it will not be as accurate, or it will not be as complete as one would like it to be, right? So then I would say, okay, I have only little knowledge in that domain, and based on whatever I know, this is the answer that I can provide. So I'll say that, okay, the confidence of my answer is less. So if the machine can also do the same thing, let's say if you have trained the machine on dog images and the different breeds of dog, but if you have fed in a parrot or penguin, then it should not be able to answer much, because it was trained on dogs and it doesn't know what a penguin is. But if you ask something about the penguin, then it should say that the confidence in my answer is very less. So if it can put out those kinds of these are also some sort of explanation, right? If it can put out those kinds of explanations related to its knowledge limits, then that's what the fourth principle is about. I know, did that make sense? Okay. So any other questions before we move on? Okay, so I'll continue. So I'll take these pauses every now and then, and you can let me know if you have any questions. Okay, so again, so this part of the next few slides are from this particular paper. So if you want to know more about the content that I'm discussing here, you can go back and read this paper. Okay, so let us look at these different types of AI systems. Again, these are all from the point of view of explainability, right? So if we have, there could be other categorizations of AI systems as well, but we are only interested in the explainability part, and this categorization is from that point of view. Okay, so you might have heard of this term called black box model, right? And that's the first system that we'll be looking at. So it's also called the opaque system or the black box model. So the black box model is named that way because it's not transparent, right? So you cannot look into the contents of this box. So there are these white box systems and black box systems. In black box, you cannot see the contents, and it's hidden. So you don't know what techniques this model is using. So for example, you are the model is given the image of it's given some image. So in this case, it's the image of a factory, right? It has these machines on the floor, and it has all these lights, halogen lights and so on. And so this is the image of a factory. And if you show this image to a human, maybe the human can recognize or say some things related to the factory. It may not be an exact answer, but related answers. Let's say it's a manufacturing plant or something like that. So the idea is, given this image, can this model recognize what the image is about? And in this case, it was able to recognize that it's a factory, but we don't know why it has given out that decision, right? Or that that sort of classification result. So that's why it's called a black box. So the machine cannot explain the answer, and neither can the human. So the human cannot say why this particular image resulted in this decision by the AI algorithm. So that's why there's a puzzled look here. So that's the most common type of systems or models that you come across. Most of them are black box models. So second type of AI system here, again, from the explainability point of view, is called is interpretable systems. So in interpretable systems, you can map some of these inputs to the outputs. And in that sense, it's more transparent, right, compared to this one. So that's why there's the image of this white box. So this is black box, where the contents are not visible. And this is the white box, where the contents are visible. and you are able to map certain inputs to the output. Let's say the inputs could be that there are machines lying on the floor, right? Or this is one of the features, right? That you can look at the features, the number of, the size of this the plant, for example, and the number of machines and so on. So if there's a way to have some sort of mapping from the input to the output, then those are called as interpretable systems because they are more transparent compared to these black box models. And the third category is comprehensible systems, where it is a black box again. So there is no mapping from input to output, but it can put out these symbols as forms of explanation. So these symbols can be words, or it can be pieces of this image, certain subsets of this image, or it can also be, let's say the features that are the important features that were used. So in some form, this is able to explain its deletion, right? So in this case, it has put out these words. It said that there's halogen lights, concrete floor, boxes and machines. And that is the reason why it has classified this as a factory. Right, so there is more, there is some explanation to it, but this explanation depends on our background knowledge. Let's say I'm not very familiar with this domain, right? Let's say we take the domain of healthcare, radiology. Maybe there's a image in it, some kind of X-ray or something, and now it has put out some symbols. And I'm not a medical practitioner, neither do I have any knowledge in the medical domain. So even if it has put out some sort of medical terms, it's hard for me to make sense of it, right? So I cannot use these terms to get an explanation for this deletion, unless I have background, some sort of background knowledge about these terms. And later on, we'll see that this is where the semantics comes in, right? It's helpful in this particular case where it can act as a substitute for the background knowledge. So the explanation accuracy, as we have seen earlier, so explanation accuracy now depends on your background knowledge. If you have sufficient background knowledge to make sense of these terms and connect these terms together, then you can say that the explanation is fairly good for this particular patient. But if you don't have sufficient background knowledge, then this doesn't make much sense for you. Okay, so let's look at another example, which will hopefully explain these three systems better. Right, okay, so let's say you have some sort of ailment and you have visited a doctor. You visited a doctor and explained your symptoms, and the doctor has given out a diagnosis, or probably some sort of medication. So the diagnosis includes the medication, right? So you went to the doctor, you explained your the ailment and the symptoms that you had, and the doctor analyzes it and gives out the medications, and that's it. So you walk away. So now the doctor, you did not ask for any explanation, and the doctor did not give it, which is not generally the case. But let's say if that is the case, then that is an example of the opaque system. Or let's say the doctor refuses to give any explanation, right? So you go in, the doctor asks for the symptoms and then puts out a diagnosis, which is some list of medications. And when you ask for an explanation, the doctor says that he or she cannot provide the explanation for it, and you simply have to walk away. So in this case, you do not, or you cannot trust the decision that was given out, the diagnosis that was given out, right? Because you do not know anything about it and it might affect your health. So it's not likely that you will trust the decision. So that's what an opaque system is. And let's say in the second case, the doctor puts out the diagnosis, but you start asking these questions as to why certain medications were prescribed, what does the doctor think about the ailment that you have, and so on. So in this case, the doctor uses some high-level indicators. Because we are not from the medical background, so the doctor may not explain it in detail, right? So for example, the doctor might ask you to undergo a few tests, let's say a blood test. Based on some of these results, the doctor might say, okay, because of, let's say the hemoglobin level is low, and that's why the doctor has prescribed something. So he might say that he or she might say that okay, because of this reason I have prescribed these medicines. So that is some sort of high level explanation, but which will help you to build your trust in the diagnosis that was given out. So this is an example of the comprehensible model, because certain symbols were put out. In this case, these indicators, right? Because let's say if the temperature is above a certain threshold, then the doctor might prescribe some medications. So that is an indicator. But later on, let's say the doctor takes your medical tests and the doctor starts discussing the diagnosis that was put out for this particular ailment with their fellow colleagues. Let's say it could be medical staff or fellow doctors or maybe doctor students who are trying to analyze these test results. So then the doctor would give a more technical explanation, right? So the doctor will try to connect the symptoms with the ailments and the reason why he has prescribed certain tests and the results of the test with the diagnosis. So there'll be a complete or he'll try to connect it as much as possible, the end to end. So from the inputs to the output. The input in this case is the ailment and the symptoms, and the output is the diagnosis. So in this case, it is the interpretable model, because it was you. He was able to connect. He or she was able to connect the inputs, which are the symptoms, with the diagnosis. Right. So broadly, those are the three systems: opaque, comprehensible, and the interpretable system. Okay, let me go on. So, any questions so far? Let me take. Okay. So, associated with the explanation for a system, there are other traits or characteristics. Right? So, these are related to the explainability part, but although they are different, but they are related, right? So many of these explainable systems also have some of these characteristics or traits, or they are related to each other. So we'll briefly look at it, but I'll not be talking about any of these aspects in this particular talk, right? But yeah, you can maybe go back and learn more about them if there is interest. Okay, so let's say you have a AI model that makes use of machine learning or deep learning, some learning techniques. And again, in order to have some confidence or trust in the decisions that was put out, you need these explanations. So there's a connection, between, or strong connection between trust and explanation, right? And the same thing with all the other aspects as well. Let's say there is ethical related issues or safety related issues or fairness related issues. So if there is explanation, apart from explainability, there are other ways to ensure that all these characteristics are part of the system. But explainability is also related to these characteristics, right? So let's say if you want to know whether the system has taken an ethical decision or not, or whether the decision taken by the system is safe or not. So in order to know that, it's good to have the explanation for the decision. And once you go over the explanation, you can get to know whether you can take a decision, right? Whether it's safe or not, whether it's ethical or not, and so on. So that is the broadly the relationship between explainability and these characteristics or traits. Okay. So some time back I talked about this historical perspective. So explainably, AI is not something that has popped up recently. So there has been work on explainable AI for several decades now, and we'll briefly look at this, right? So broadly, and again, if you want to know more about the historical perspective and in general about explainable AI, so this is a good paper, and the link is given here, so you can browse it and then maybe read it more, get to know more. So broadly, from the point of view of explainable AI, the authors have categorized the work that has been done into three generations. And the way they have looked at it is by looking at the papers that were published. So the x-axis indicates the year of publication starting from 1977 up to 2017. And y-axis is the count of these papers. Right? So they have used few keywords to shortlist these papers. And by going over these papers, they have categorized all the work into three categories or three generations, the first, second, and third. The first two generations are about expert systems. And the third generation is more about the deep learning neural networks, right? Which has become popular now. So in the first two generations, expert systems are generally built using these rules. So you put in these rules and they give out certain deductions, right? So a simple rule could be, let's say, if you have temperature, if the human body's temperature is more than, let's say, 98 degrees, then the person should be given, and okay, so I'm ignoring all the other things, right? Like age and other ailments that the person may have. So if you ignore all these things, if you keep it simple, then you might say, okay, every day the person should take one tablet of Dolo or something, or paracetamol. So that's a pretty simple rule. But you can, if you include all the other things, like let's say the age and the, let's say the person has hypertension or diabetes and so on. So the rule also becomes complex. So the expert systems were supposed to help the experts and in some cases also act as replacements. Let's say in cases where, let's say there's a remote village, right? In remote villages, it's hard to find doctors or good doctors. So in those cases, maybe these expert systems can act as the first point of contact. So you go to the expert system and it can give out these recommendations and maybe you can follow that. So there are cases where expert systems can also act as, in some ways, replacement for humans, and that's why it's named as an expert system, right? And in many cases, it can also aid the humans in giving out better rations. So that's about expert systems. And the first generation was based on these expert systems, and there has been work on explainable AI at that time. And in the case of expert systems, it becomes fairly simple because it has to just put out the rules that it has used to generate the ratio. So a simple rule could be whatever the example that I gave, right? Let's say if the question was, why did you recommend paracetamol? Then it can put out the rule saying that, okay, this person has temperature more than 98 degrees and that's why I suggested paracetamol. And another simple example is that of transitivity. Let's say you have x, y, and z. So if x is less than y and y is less than z, then the rule could be x is also less than z. And now if you are given these numbers 2, 3, 4, so there can be a question as to why did you say 2 is less than 4. You can put out the explanation again. You can say, okay, 2 is less than 3 and 3 is also less than 4. And that is why I have given out the answer that 2 should be less than 4 because of this particular rule, right? So explanation becomes pretty easy in this case. In the second generation, it was about, it is again related to expert systems. So there were rules, but they have enhanced these rules with some more background knowledge of the domain. And they have added rules related to the dialogues. So let's say a user is interacting with the machine or the AI model and in the form of dialogues, right? So there could be rules related to dialogues and the background knowledge and the context. So if in the second generation, there has been work again on explainable AI, but where they put out explanations related to the dialogues as well. So they were trying to improve the quality of the explanations. So that's the second generation. So first generation was roughly from 1977 to 1985, and The second one was from 85 to 95, right? Another 10 years. So after that, there is this winter, explainability winter, which coincided with the AI winter. So I don't know, maybe some of you would have heard of this term called AI winter. So the meaning of the term is that AI, so there's a lot of hype around AI and what it can do before late 90s, right? And so a lot of money was put in, and there's lots of hype as well, similar to what is happening these days. But during this period, it was not able to live up to that hype, because a lot more was expected, and it was not able to deliver for several reasons. But and that's why there was this downward curve for AI during this period, right? For, I don't know, let's say 10, 15 years, maybe 10 years. And that coincided with the explainability winter as well. So since the work in AI itself has gone down a little, the explanation work has also gone down. So there is this winter where there was sort of a break. And then with the advancement in the hardware and the amount of data that has been put out, some of the AI fields have picked up again. So these fields are mostly related to learning, automated learning, right? Like say machine learning, deep learning, and reinforcement learning kind of work, where it depends on good hardware and lots of data. So you need this training data, so to say. So in the starting from say early 2010, that decade, this work, the learning work has picked up. And many of these learning models, they are black box models. So coinciding with that, the explainability work has also picked up. And now you see that in the past, I don't know, 6-7 years, explainable AI has become quite popular. And this is what the third generation is. Right, so that's briefly the historical perspective. So you had these two generations, then there was a break, and then now we are into the third generation, where now there's a lot more focus on generating explanations for these black box models. And as I said, you can learn more, I mean, know more about it from this paper. Okay. So I'll again go over this and then maybe take a break again, right? I mean, I can pause and take questions. Okay, so that's about the explainability, which is the first phase of the talk, or the first part of the talk. So we discussed what explainability is, the importance of it, and the historical perspective and why we need explainable system. So in the second part, I'll look at the role of the semantics in generating these explanations. So there are multiple ways, obviously, of making the system explainable. And one of the techniques is to use these semantics. So I'll also talk about what I mean by semantics, but this is one of the techniques, right? And there can be other techniques, and maybe there's also another talk related to explainable AI. Maybe that speaker can talk about the role of, I don't know, so he might talk about role of semantics as well as other techniques perhaps to generate these explanations. But anyway, so let's see how this explanation can be enhanced. So this is the same picture that we have seen earlier in one of these slides, the comprehensible system, where the system has put out certain symbols as an explanation for the decision that it has taken. So certain symbols like these were put out, the halogen lights, machines, and concrete floor. And like I said, this, if you are a domain expert or if you know the domain well, then you can connect these dots. So you can connect these terms together and then make sense out of it. But if you are not a domain expert, or if you don't know much about the domain, let's say it's a medical domain, right? And it has put out certain medical terms which I haven't even heard of. So in that case, I cannot make much sense out of it, right? So you need some sort of domain knowledge in order to make sense of these terms that are put out. And that is where the semantics come in. So So let's say instead of relying on the domain knowledge of the human, we have captured this domain knowledge in a way that is processable by the machines, which we call it as knowledge base, right? Knowledge base. So I use other terms, but let's for now we can stick to this. So let's say there's a knowledge base that captures the knowledge in a particular domain. Let's say it's the domain of factory in this case, or it could be the domain of cars or certain medical field. So if it can capture these knowledge in this form, which can be processed by the machines, then you can feed in these terms to what is called as a reasoner. So reasoner is again a software that can take these facts and it can make certain inferences. So a simple example is, let's say you are given two facts. All birds fly and pigeon is a bird. So based on these two facts, you can say that pigeon can also fly, right? Because you're told that all birds fly, and since pigeon is also a bird, it should be able to fly. So reasoner is that kind of a software which can take in these facts and give out new inferences, or inferences for short. So the idea here is that, okay, you are given certain symbols or keywords that this comprehensible system has put out. Now, can it take these symbols and use this knowledge to put out a more explainable explanation, right? That means, okay, it should make more sense. So it should be more meaningful. So we can link it back to the meaningful principle of the explainable systems. So this is meaningful, but the meaningfulness depends on the domain knowledge. But if we outsource it, that means if the domain knowledge is captured in some form that is machine processable, then it can increase the meaningfulness of the explanation. Okay, so the reasoner can take this as the input and it can try to look at the relationships between all these. So for example, what is the relationship between concrete floor and machine and factory? So once these relationships are established, it can put out a better explanation, right? And which is what this is. So although it's hard to put out such a lengthy explanation, but if you can find the relationships between them, which is part of the knowledge base, you can improve the meaningfulness of this explanation. So this is what we mean by the semantics. This part here is the semantics, and I'll talk a bit more about that in the next few slides, right? So the combination of knowledge base and the reasoner is what I mean by semantics. But yeah, like I said, I'll talk about that in the next few slides. But I can take a pause again, and then if you have any questions, I can take them. Yeah, I can try to answer them. Okay, so there is one question. Can we move from opaque to comprehensible or interpretable without retraining? Okay, so the difference between all these systems is not related to training or the output, right? The outcome is the same and the training remains the same. The aspect that changes among all these systems is this explanation. In some of these systems, it's able to put out, or in the comprehensible system, it can put out these symbols. In the opaque system, it does not, there's no explanation at all. In the interpretable system, there is some sort of mapping from the input to the output. So it's not related to training at all, but it's how you induce explanation into the system, right? So is there a way to induce this explanation and get the explanation for a particular action? So that is part of the explainable AI work. Okay, so anything? So are there any other questions? Okay, so before I get started with the semantics, right, I'll give you this demo. And hopefully that can make things a bit more clear, right? So there are two demos, sort of demos, right? So, okay, one is on this in the field of finance or finance fintech, so to say, where you have, so the idea is again, you a person goes or an organization is seeking a loan, and now there are multiple people involved in this decision making process. You have the loan officer, you have the bank customer. So the customer wants a loan, and the loan officer is the intermediary. Right? So the loan officer takes the request, and then he sends it for further processing, and then maybe the loan officer also gives out the result and explains it why the certain decisions has been taken. And there is this data scientist at the back, in the background, where he or she takes this input and the history, kind of all the other details, right? Like the historical detail, like what kind of job this person has, what's the salary, what are the assets that they may have, and so on. And based on all these things, all this data, the data scientist can run some algorithms and give out some decision, and which can be used further by the loan officer and other humans to make this decision. So let's, let me just put this link in the chat so that you can also play around with it later on. The first step was to choose the role, the consumer type, or one of these roles. So let me go for the bank customer, because we want a reason, right? We are looking at it from the explainability point of view. So that, let's see what the explanation is. Okay, so in this case, the bank customer wants to understand. So the request was for a loan, and they want to understand whether the application has been rejected or accepted. And if it has been rejected, why it has been rejected, right? So that maybe later on they can improve that aspect and reapply either to that bank or to a different bank. Okay, that's what it says. So if you know the reason, you can maybe increase the likelihood of the application getting accepted, maybe in the next round, or go to a different bank and try to apply again. So in this case, three customers have applied for the loan, and all these three customers were denied the loan, right? Let's again look at the explanation for it. So the system was able to give out this explanation. So it says, okay, several features lie outside the acceptable range, and now it talks about these features. So the importance of these features is given here. Right? So it has used three features, and there could be other factors, but these are the three top factors in that have contributed to the rejection of the loan application. And the explanation has been provided here. And similarly, you can take a look at other cases as well, and it will vary a bit, right? So the top factors that contributed to the rejection of the loan have been provided here. So now there is a difference, right? So let's say if this explanation was not provided, maybe the customer, it would not have been a good experience for the customer, because now the customer does not know why it has been rejected, and how can it be improved, right? So let's say, how can the chances of accepting the loan application later on could have been improved. So these things could have, the customer would not know, and it would have resulted in a bad customer experience. So this sort of improves the customer experience, and it also helps the customer if we have this kind of explanation. So that's one example. And let's go to the other example as well, which is on visual question answering. So given these images, now you can start answering. You can start asking questions about these images, and the system can give out the answers to these related to the images, right? So again, let me put this in the chat, and you can play around with that. So this is in German, right? So it might ask you to switch to the English language, and Google Translate will help us with that. So, okay, let us take a few of these images, and let's see what kind of answers we get. So this, you can type in these kinds of questions. Is the person on the left female? Or let's say, so I'll type in, is there a dog in this picture. It is very simple for us, but it might not be straightforward for the machine. Right? Or there could be other questions that we could ask. Okay. So it was working some time back, but I don't know if it stopped working, right? So let me refresh and see how it goes. Okay, my internet is working, right? It's not an issue with my internet. You are able to hear and see me, right? Can someone let me know?
Yes, all good.
Okay, so it's not an issue with my internet. Okay, unfortunately, this site went down. But it was working just an hour back. So, okay, I don't know. So, okay, I can't even have the cached version.
Raghav, in the previous example, the previous demonstration, were there hard-coded questions or there are also the customer was asking the questions of his choice?
No, in this example, it was fixed, right?
Yes.
So it was for loan application and it gives the explanation for why it has been accepted or why it has been rejected. And it gives out the top features that led to the rejection or the acceptance of the loan application. So these are the top features that were that led to this denial in this case.
The risk was high and so on. Yeah, these can be the only two questions in this use case. That is true.
Right. So it can either be an acceptance or rejection followed by the explanation.
Yeah.
So from that point of view, you are right. So this is more open-ended. You can ask, any question, but related to this image, right? So, okay, this is the second attempt. Let me make the second attempt if it works. So it's a dog. If it doesn't work, maybe, okay, I guess it's not working again. So you can take a look at this one later on, like maybe try it after a few more hours. And this was pretty interesting, right? So I can maybe talk a bit about the output. So what it does is...
I can see this is again Germany.
True. Yeah, it's the same link. So I tried to refresh it.
I mean to say, from where was the previous one? This is Fraunhofer, Germany.
In
Europe, people are working the most.
In general, I don't know about the question answering part. Okay, there is good amount of work in Europe about on question answering as well. But on the semantics aspect, say semantic web and all, Germany is the major hub, right? Like there are lots of well-known research groups and Germany and Europe in general, they are leading the work in terms of the semantics and semantic web. But I'm not sure about the question answering part. I think there is good amount of work in US and other places as well.
I see. You mean to say this is question answering? I thought this is explanation.
No. So, it's question answering, but it does give out the explanation.
Okay.
So, for example, in the output, so let's say if I type this question, the answer would be that you will get an yes, followed by the confidence score of that answer. And then it will try to highlight the portion of the image that it has used in order to answer this question. So, that's the explanation. So, it will highlight the portion, the doc portion, and it will dim the other parts. So if we pick, let's say, the other question that I asked was, how many elephants are there in this image? So it was able to give out the answer as two. There are two elephants. And again, there's a confidence score associated with the answer. And it will also highlight the portion of the image which it has used to answer the question. And that is the explanation, right? So the portion here would be this one and until this one. So it will highlight this part and it will dim the other parts. So that's a visual explanation of the answer that it has provided. Yeah, but unfortunately, yeah, we can't. So for example, here, this was the other example that I tried. So you can again ask, is there a haystack in this image? So the prominent portion is this sheep, right? There's a sheep, there are rocks and so on. The haystack is lying somewhere here. But it was able to recognize that there is a haystack in this image, and it will highlight only this part and it will dim the other parts. And that's the explanation that it provides, right? That okay, there is a haystack, and this is the reason why I said there is a haystack. So now you can develop some sort of confidence in the answer that it is giving out. But like I said, I mean, I don't know, hopefully it will start working after some time. So you can give it a try again later on. Let's see if, I don't know. Okay, so it's not. So let me try one more time and then, is it related to WebEx? Somehow? I don't know. I'm not sure. Okay. Let me just. Okay. So I don't know. Okay. I don't know what. So I don't know why this, like WebEx is seems to be interfering with it, but I don't know.
Yeah, you can say continue here.
Yeah, okay, but
so WebEx is not a problem, I feel, because okay. WebEx always asks that if you want to go to some external site, so we allowed, but then also it couldn't bring anything from there. Maybe the server is down.
Could be. So I'll try to. There was one more demo. I don't know. No, not this. So I looked at two more demos.
You could run another browser if possible, and that will be sure that the server is down.
Okay, so okay, so I'll try, but okay, let's say it will take a few more seconds, I think. So there's one more okay, let me see if I can, if there's one more demo which I thought was good. Okay, this one, I guess. No, not this one. Okay, I don't know. I can't find it now. Yeah, whenever Firefox comes up, I'll try to run this example or this website on Firefox as well. But yeah, for now, we can, I guess, continue. Okay, so it has told up. Okay, so I'll give it one more try, and if it doesn't work, we can just simply move on, right? You can try it at a different time. So not this one. Okay, so I guess it's not working. Okay, so let's continue, and maybe the server would be up at some point in time and you can check it again. But that's what that work does, right? So it'll highlight the portion of the image that has led to the answer, and that's the explanation that it provides. So it's a visual explanation instead of using words to explain the deletion. Okay. So in the previous slide, I talked about these using semantics or the background knowledge to improve the meaningfulness of this explanation, right? So, but before we proceed, let's take a brief pause again and look at these semantics. So in order to know, in order to use semantics, you need to know what semantics mean or what at least I mean by semantics. So the idea behind this is that we should be able to capture the meaning associated with any data, right? So in the form of these concepts and the relations. And W3C, which stands for World Wide Web Consortium, has put out certain standards, which come under the broad umbrella of semantic web. And these are all semantic web technologies. So the two technologies that we'll be looking at is RDF and OWL. RDF stands for Resource Description Framework, and OWL is the Web Ontology Language. Let me briefly talk about these two, and then I'll continue. Okay. So RDF is something that you can use to describe any resource in the world, right? It could be living thing, non-living thing, abstract, physical. So for example, you can use it to describe a table or a chair or a car. So you can say that car is something that has exactly one engine, at least two doors, at most two doors. But you can describe all these things in a way that the machine can also read and understand. And the mechanism to do that is through this triple. So there are three things that are part of the triple: a subject, a predicate, and an object. So predicate is the binary relation between subject and object. So here, Delhi is the subject, capital of is the predicate or the binary relation between Delhi and India. And you can represent these triples in the form of a graph, where the nodes are the subject and object, and the edge label is the predicate. And this, then the direction is always from subject to the object. Right, let's see if little more complex example, or okay, we can also switch to this one. So this is a graph which talks about two aspects, right? Two things. One is Alice and the other one is the image of Mona Lisa. So, okay. So you have Bob and Alice. Bob is a person and Bob knows Alice. So this is one, this is a subject and that is Bob. The predicate here is knows. So for now you can ignore what Fof is and just focus on the last part of the predicate, right, which is knows. And the other node here is Alice. So Bob knows Alice. Bob is of type person. So Bob is a, so this is a concept and this is an instance of that concept. So it is very similar to object-oriented programming, where you have classes and objects which are instances of classes. Right? So these instance of one type of instance of person, but there can be other instances, right? Like, for example, Alice is a type of person, and every Raghava is a type of person, and so on. And Bob has a birth date, and that is a predicate, and this is the date that is given here. So this is the graph, and Bob has a interest in Mona Lisa. So maybe Bob is interested in paintings, and one of the paintings that he is interested in is Mona Lisa. And now this is a graph related to Mona Lisa, right? And there is a connection between these two graphs. So Mona Lisa's creator is Leonardo, and there's a video, this is a video, and there's a video associated with the painting, and so on, right? So you can also, using these triples, you were able to describe several resources here. One resource is Bob, the other resource is Alice, and the third resource is Mona Lisa. So you can also further describe Leonardo and so on. So you can keep describing these resources in the form of triples. And the idea behind this is, so you are converting unstructured data into some sort of structured form, right? So you are able to capture the knowledge in this particular domain. The domain here is that of Mona Lisa, Leonardo, and Bob and Alice into a structured format. And you can make use of this structured format to answer questions or to provide more explanations or better explanations. So this is RDF, and the other one is what is called as an ontology. So ontologies are something that you create using this web ontology language, and ontologies can capture the relationships between the important concepts in the particular domain. So in this case, we want to capture the relationship between heart, circulatory system, and a muscular organ. So we say that we want to say that heart is a muscular organ that is part of the circulatory system, right? So both OWL and RDF are created, or are the basis of both of them is first order logic. So these are subsets of first order logic that were used to create these two technologies, RDF and OWL, right? And that's why you see these symbols that are from first order logic. So there is for all X. So if X is a heart, then X is a muscular organ. So that's where you see the connection between heart and muscular organ. And there is a Y such that X is a part of Y, and that Y is a circulatory system. So you are converting this English language system into a set of symbols that can be used by the machine. So now machine can go over this, and then it can try to make use of this. It can try to make use of this fact, right? In either generating better explanations, which is the use case for us, or it can also use it for answering questions or making inferences and so on. So the other example that I talked about in the previous FDP, which many of you may not have attended, is this movie example, right? So in the we want to capture the knowledge of a particular domain, and in this case the domain is that of a movie industry. So you list out the important terms, which is let's say we want to capture the details of a movie genre, the actor. So all these are movie crew, and actor is a subclass of movie crew, which is similar to a subset. So for example, you have mammals is a subset of animal class or animal set, right? There are lots of animals, and among them only some of them are mammals. So this one is a subset of the other. So in the same way, you can think of actors as a subset or a subclass of movie crew, and director is also a subclass of movie crew. So director is also part of the movie crew, right? And producer is also part of the movie crew. So these are all some of the important terms, and we also wanted to capture the rating of the movie. So these are the concepts, and now we can link them together using these properties. So there is a has genre property, has protagonist property, and so for now, you can ignore the differences between data and object properties and just treat them as properties. And you have other properties like the duration of a movie, the language of a movie, the revenue that it was able to generate. So how much money was put into making this movie, and how much profits or loss did it get? So that is all part of the revenue, right? So we were able to connect these important concepts together using these relationships, and that captures the knowledge or some of the knowledge in this domain, right? So you can also convert this statement into something of this nature, where you can capture the relationship between heart, muscular organ, and circulatory system, right? So both of them, RDF and ontologies, they are used to capture the knowledge in a particular domain. But there is a slight difference between them, right? So in the case of the ontologies, you capture it at the abstract level. So you talk about person. So for example, you will say that faculty members work at a university. So that's the ontology, right? But in the case of RDF graph, in general, you will say that Raghava works at IIIT Delhi. So Raghava is a type of faculty member. IIIT Delhi is a type of university, and you are connecting these two. So if it is at the instance level, that's generally the knowledge graph or the RDF graph. And if it is at the more abstract concept level, then that's the schema level information, or which is captured in the form of an ontology. So if we associate, and this is what we mean by, or at least I mean by, semantics, right? So you have some sort of meaning associated with this data, and you are also capturing the relationships between these important concepts, right? So that forms the semantics. So now we can go back and try to relate this semantics with that, with this, right? So now we have a knowledge base. So assume that this is, you have an ontology plus some RDF associated with it, and together it's called a knowledge base. And you also have a reasoner that can take in these symbols or the words, make use of this knowledge to produce the relationships. So it can put out the relationships between all these symbols, and it can also maybe draw some more inferences. So based on that, the meaningfulness property of the explanation has been increased. So earlier it was not so meaningful, but using the knowledge base, it became more meaningful. Right? So that's the role of semantics. That's the role semantics can play in explainable AI. So again, I'll take a brief pause. And yeah, if you have any questions, I can answer them. Okay, looks like there are no questions, right? So let me move ahead. So that was the second part of the talk. In the first part, I talked about the overview, gave a brief overview of the explainability part, explainability, why it is required, and how it is helpful, the principles and so on, right? In the second part, I talked about the role of the semantics, what are semantics, and what is RDF, what is an ontology, in brief, and how it can play a role in improving the explainability of an AI system. So that's the second part. And the third part, which is also the final part of the talk, I'll take a specific system, a specific work, which has made use of these knowledge graphs for generating the explanation. Again, so this work, so this is from this particular paper, which is given here. So if you want to learn more about this particular work, you can go and read this paper. Okay, so this particular work or system is named as RippleNet, and the idea behind this is, or the motivation here is, it's a recommendation system, and it's a movie recommendation system, right? So just like in, let's say you have Netflix or Amazon Prime, and the user has watched a few movies. So in this case, the user has watched Castaway, Back to the Future, and The Green Mile. So there are few movies that this user has watched. And now the system has to recommend more movies based on this input. Based on the history of the user, the system needs to figure out the likes and dislikes of the user and then recommend accordingly, right? But the goal of this system is that along with the recommendations, it should also put out an explanation as to why, for example, it has recommended Interstellar, or why it has recommended Forrest Gump. So movies that the user may also like. So this is very, you can also observe this on Netflix. For example, if you have watched a few movies, and Netflix would give out recommendations, and along with the recommendations, it will also started giving out the explanations for it. So it will say that, okay, I'm recommending Interstellar because you are interested in the adventure genre. Or maybe you can say that, you can say I am recommending Forrest Gump because you like watching Tom Hanks movies. Because two of the movies that you have watched earlier are from Tom Hanks, right? So these are some of the explanations that it can put out. But you can replace this movie domain with anything else. So for example, you can replace it with the news let's say it's a news aggregating website, and you went over certain news articles, and now it wants to recommend related news pieces. Right. So it, again, you can use similar kind of system in that case as well. You can also make use of this in the e-commerce domain. So let's say you're browsing things in the Amazon website or Flipkart, for example, right? And you have browsed a few things, and now based on your browsing history, it can recommend items that are related to it, or based on the things that you have already purchased, you can also recommend things that are similar to, or things that could be of interest to you. So yeah, so you can replace this domain, but the principles more or less, they remain the same. Okay, so let's take a brief look at how RippleNet makes these recommendations and also uses the knowledge graph in this. So knowledge graph is same as in our case, so for our purpose, it's same as the RDF graph. So it makes use of this graph to give out the recommendations. Okay. So the first step is to create this graph, right? So from the user history, it has mapped the user history to in the form of this graph. So this graph consists of different nodes and edges. So some of the nodes can be the names of the movies, the actors and the directors that are part. So there are people that can be nodes. There are movie names that can be part of the nodes. The genre could be also part of the node. So all these are different nodes. And there is, assume that there is a graph already that has been built. And now the first step is to map the movies and the things that the user has done as part of the browsing history or the history of the user and map them to the graph. So the so let's say the user is interested in Tom Hanks movies. So you need to be able to map Tom Hanks, this term, to the Tom Hanks in the graph. So that's the first step. And the second step is what RippleNet did was, it was able to, it has translated these words into embeddings. So embeddings are these low dimensional vectors. Right, so you can convert these words into, let's say, ones and zeros. So now you can and create a vector out of it. So once you create a vector, you can perform vector operations on it. Right, like you can check whether one vector is similar to the other vector by using, for example, cosine similarity. So you can perform all these vector operations and make some decisions out of it. So the first step is to do this mapping. Second step is to convert the browsing history into a form of vector embeddings. And the third step is to propagate them. So while propagating, and that's where the term ripple comes in. So let's say you have a pond, small pond or bucket of water, and you put a stone in it. So if you put the stone, it will result in these concentric circles, right? But as the from the point of impact, as you go further along, the circles, the circumference of the circle, it increases, keeps increasing. Or the radius, yeah, whatever. Okay, so the radius keeps increasing, and the effect also comes down, right? So when if you throw a stone here, then the circle is small, but it is very closer to the impact. So it's sort of the effect is higher. But as you go along, the circle size increases, but it's not. Although circle size is higher, but it's not as impactful, so to say, right? As when it's closer to the point of contact. So they take the same principle here. So let's say this is the graph. And if you start at this particular node, then the closer you are to this particular node in terms of hops, so this is one hop. And if you jump to the second node from this node, that's the second hop. And this is the third hop, right? So as the number of hops increase, the relevancy decreases. So this factor has been added to the algorithm. So for, after you capture the information in the form of the embeddings, the information of the user, right, the browsing history of the user, it is propagated along these edges. So whenever it's propagated, as when and when the hops increase, the impact of it decreases or the relevancy decreases. So the relevance of My Heart will go on to Forrest Gump is low, and the same is the case with Forrest Gump and let's say some other movie in the third hop, right? That's pretty low. So it tries to use these hops to re-rank this the movie recommendations, right? And then it'll try to stick to the one or two hops, because as the number of hops increases, the relevancy decreases. So based on these two things, it will recommend these movies. So given Castaway, Back to the Future, Green Mile, and the users, any other browsing history, right? It was able to recommend these three movies. And because it has followed, these hops in order to recommend a movie, it can also give out the explanation. So for example, when it gives out the recommendation of Forrest Gump, it will say that because you have watched movies of this director and this actor, I have given out the recommendation of Forrest Gump, because it has the same director and actor. So that's the, and this is the semantics part, the knowledge graph part, which you were able to traverse and put out the explanation, right? So although it's the main idea behind this is to have the recommendation, but it's also able to generate the explanation for that recommendation. Like, is that, does that make sense? On the usage of semantics for generating explanations. So if, so this other sort of pause again, right? So if you have any questions, you can let me know and I can try to answer them.
Guys, you could unmute yourself if you want to get details of even RippleNet or the semantics, how do we incorporate in explainability?
Hello, so this is Dr. Richa.
Yes, yeah, please go on.
Yeah, so actually you talked about this RippleNet and the hop count, when hop count actually increases, and then My Heart Will Go On will be a little bit similar to Forrest Gump. So what is actually this hop count where the it needs to stop, the semantic, this thing needs to stop, first thing. And second thing, if you can see, sir, My Heart Will Go On or other things, the terminal, they are, if you will go on hop by hop, then at some point of time, we feel that everything is somehow related. So how could we just distinguish in the recommendation, then it will be like not very fruitful recommendation. It will not be counted as good recommendation. So at which point of time we need to stop over here that, okay, this is the semantic thing and this is the related recommendation for that.
Okay, yeah, sure. Okay, so there are two aspects here, right? So one is, okay, let me make it full screen. So one aspect that needs to be considered is the browsing history. And the second aspect that needs to be considered is the hop count or the number of hops that are away. So let's say if, and that's why for in order to consider the browsing history, they have taken the embeddings or converted this to a vector, right? So that the information of the browsing history is preserved. And now they propagate that vector across these edges, right? So let's say if they start with Forrest Gump, and there are obviously other, there's a big graph and there are other edges which are, let's say from, which go from Castaway or that are linked to PG-13. There are several movies that are PG-13, right? So you can keep propagating them across the edges, but as you propagate, the similarity of this vector with this particular vector would decrease. So for example, if you capture these in the form of vector, let's say, just for sake of example, we can take one, right? Say Castaway. So there's a relation, there's a similarity between Castaway and Forrest Gump, but there may not be a similarity between, Jurassic Park, like say Jurassic Park and Castaway, right? So Jurassic Park is also a PG-13 movie, let's assume that. And then now, if you propagate this particular information up till Jurassic Park, then the score that you would get is very low. But if you compare Castaway with Forrest Gump, the score would be higher. So that's one part of it. And the second part of it is the hop count that you mentioned. So as you go along, even if it is related, right? Let's say Forrest Gump, Castaway, the terminal, Titanic are related in some ways, but as the hop count increases, the relevancy decreases. So maybe something that is at third level, which is My Heart Will Go On, is not as relevant to Forrest Gump as let's say Castaway, which is at the second hop. So it makes use of both these factors. One is the browsing history and the second is the hop count. So the further it is from the main node, the start node, the less relevant it is, right? So, and where to stop? So that was the other question. So generally there's a threshold that is associated with all these things. Let's say if the score falls below 0.7 or 0.6, then you can stop there. So let's say at the third hop, the score now is 0.55, right? Which is less than 0.6. So now it can stop going further. So you can adjust the threshold so that if you are interested in getting more accurate answers, you can increase the threshold, let's say to 0.85 or 0.9. And then it might stop, let's say, even after hop 2. So that's generally how the propagation proceeds. Did that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Almost you just cleared all the doubts. One more thing, sir, I would like to ask that. So basically, it would be depending on my analysis that where I should stop this hop count.
Or right, threshold. Right. Generally, it's the threshold. So you can adjust the threshold. But since you want it to be very pretty accurate, you can keep the threshold to be high, right? Like, let's say 0.85, 0.9 or... I don't know, 0.8 or something. Okay. So then it'll stop at that point.
Okay. One more thing. So if I would like to start with this.
Just to add. So the threshold can be either that or it can be also time, right? Let's say if you are in a real time kind of setting. So in Netflix, you cannot wait forever to give out the recommendation for the next movie. You want it to be quick. So a threshold can also be the time. And so if it is one or two hops away, then the response would be pretty quick, right? Can browse the graph and give out the results. But if you are, if it's going to third, fourth, 10th, fifth hops, then it will take more time. So let's say the threshold can be a combination of the accuracy, say which is 0.85 and so on, and the time. The time could be 1 second or, maybe 1 second or 1.5 seconds. So it could be a combination.
May I add upon it? I don't know. Density? Could it be density also of every circle, concentric circle? Because otherwise, it will also take time to process that very, very dense circle.
Right. So density meaning the
Of related entities it has found in that particular circle. Maybe it is very
Right. So that's right. So if it has, so let's say in Netflix, you only want to show the top, 3 or 4, right? It doesn't make sense. Even if you collect 15 movies as recommended movies, you cannot put out all the 15. You just need to put out the top 3 or 4. So yeah, if you find the top 3 or 4 in the first level itself, then that's good. You can stop.
Right, sir. Exactly. So, one more thing I would like to ask. So, this is what in this given paper RippleNet they have provided few one such glimpse. So if somebody would like to try these movies on their own understanding, or if they want to have their own knowledge graph for these things, so what could be the what would you suggest, what would be the possible scenarios that one should keep in mind? Because this is such a small scenario that few they have taken obviously I have read the paper, they have a huge knowledge graph for that. This is what a simple snapshot of small glimpse they have given.
Right.
So what do you suggest, sir, about this knowledge graph if somebody would like to try on their own knowledge graph for movies, let's say?
Right. So there is there is an existing knowledge graph for movies, right? So there is they have taken IMDb, which is the international movie database, and they have formed a graph out of it. So if you search for it, you should be able to get like IMDb RDF graph or something. You should be able to find it, or RDF data set of IMDb. So you should get it, right? That should be available. And now there are other popular existing graphs as well. So there is something called DVPR. So you can take a look at DVPR's graph, or there are a lot more graphs. So you can say, so you can check for linked open data cloud. Where is it? Yeah, okay. So when it loads, you will see lots of circles, right? So all these are graphs which are again linked together. So okay, let's go here. So if you are interested in the geographical domain, then these are already the graphs that are out there. There is something called geo names and all these things. And if you are looking at some of the social networking kind of data, then these are the graphs. So these are also publicly available, and that's why it's called open, because they are publicly available. And these are the RDF triples that we talked about in the form of graphs. And there are lots of, and if you're interested in linguistics, life sciences, or media, you can find lots of other graphs as well, and you can make use of them. Right? And this includes some of the BBC, the information from the BBC and New York Times and so on. Did that answer your question? So there are lots of these linked open data is one, and you can also search for there's something called Wikidata also, which is again popular. So these are resources that have been created from Wikipedia, and as well as people have added, there are volunteers and people add knowledge, the people add the facts to these different graphs, which are also not, which may not be part of Wikipedia. So it's a combination of multiple different sources.
Thank you so much, sir.
So are there any other questions? Okay, so let me move on. And this is the last slide, right, so to say. So we have looked at, just to summarize, so we have looked at a brief overview of explainability, the motivation behind it, and why is it required, and so on, the principles behind explainability. Then I have talked about the role of semantics in generating these explanations or improving the explanations. And I also briefly talked about the semantic web technologies, or what we mean by semantics, which is RDF and OWL, resource description framework, and web ontology language, right? And how do you, what is the role played by them in generating the explanations? And in third part, I briefly talked about one particular work, which is RippleNet, that makes use of knowledge graphs to generate explanations for the recommendations that it puts out. So those are the three parts of the talk. So I'll end it with some open challenges, right? So the first one is, so it's not as such related to explainability. So this is a more of a general challenge. So knowledge matching is, let's say you have data and so you have this data, cast away, you found this in the text, right? So the first step is to match this to an entity or something in the knowledge graph. Let's say either a property or a node in the knowledge graph. So mapping this text entity to the knowledge graph entity is challenging sometimes, because the spelling could be different, or it could even be completely different. Let's say Narendra Modi and Prime Minister of India are the same, right? But let's say you have Narendra Modi in the graph and you have Prime Minister of India in the text. So how do you map these two, right? So that's the matching problem here. Or it could also be Barack Obama and Obama, right? Obama and Barack Obama. Although there are other members in the Obama family, when someone says Obama, it most likely means Barack Obama. So, and it needs to be mapped. So that's the mapping problem, which is important from the knowledge graph point of view. The second one is the multiple different forms of explanations, right? So we have looked at a couple of different forms. One was the symbols that it's putting out. The other form could be lengthy sentences. And the third form could be the images. So parts of the image can be put out as an explanation. So there are different forms of explanation. And in the sense, there is no universal one form, right? So if depending on the application and the model that is used, the explanations could vary. The form of the explanation could vary. It can be one word or one phrase, or it can be sentence, or it can be a piece of the image, and so on. So if the forms of the explanation are different, then how do you evaluate them? So these two are linked with each other. So let's say, how do you say that the explanation is meaningful, or how do you say that the explanation is accurate, right? So, and if there are different forms of explanation, it becomes hard to provide the metrics for it. So how do you say that an explanation based on the image is better or worse compared to the explanation given out by the phrase, text phrase? So they are different, and because of the different forms, it becomes harder. And that's also one of the challenges, right? So how do you quantitatively evaluate this explanation? So, okay, you have given out, the system has given out some explanation, but how good is it and how meaningful is it is something that's hard to measure. So right now it's mostly based on user feedback, but can we also quantitatively measure it? Like, can we say that, okay, it is 80% accurate, or it is, 70% meaningful or something. So for that, we need these common evaluation metrics. And it should be common because there are different forms, right? So are there metrics that are common to these different forms of explanations? And if there are, then how do you use these metrics to come up with this quantitative measure, right? So that's the other open challenge. To not to have this common evaluation metrics, maybe you can develop this common vocabulary or the language in the form of an ontology, and that could be one mechanism. But this is an ongoing research work. Okay, so with that, I'll stop, and I have added some more references right at the end. And in order to know more about explainability and all, I mean, you can go back and look at some of these references. Okay, so I'll stop there, and if you have any questions, I can answer them.
Could you recommend some references as RippleNet means one or two basic references for semantic explainability.
So I would also like to ask what are the best possible way if somebody wants to explore this knowledge graph and this explanation thing. I have explored explanation in normal recommendation, but I have not explored this explanation in, using this knowledge graph for these things. So could you please give a brief insight that how could I need to process about if I would like to pursue these open challenges?
Sure, I think, okay, so these two questions are sort of related, right? Like Dr. Sarika also asked about...
Yes, sir, exactly.
So I can give out these slides as well, but so I think this is one of the references that I found useful. So this talks about using semantic web technologies for generating explanations. So yeah, I think maybe this could be the starting point. So this is sort of a review paper, right? So it's about, I don't know, a few pages, 10 to 15 pages, I think. And this is a, this, I found it to be good. So maybe this could be the starting point where you can get an overview of different pieces of work that have been done where it makes use of semantic web technologies for generating the explanations. Link to the paper, is it? So if you search for it, you should be able to find it. This is publicly available, so it's not from what I remember, it's publicly available, right? Because it's published in a workshop at ISWC, so it should be publicly available. And yeah, it's not behind a paywall or something. Let me check if yeah, I think this is, this was also one particular kind of work which made use of semantic web technologies. Okay, so this was, but I would say this is the first, this would be the first paper that I would recommend, the one from Seeliger, right, on using semantic web technologies, and this is the other one. This could be helpful as well. Yeah, so that would be my recommendations. So any other questions?
I think these two references could be sufficient because the first one is itself a review paper and that too, a latest one, 2019.
Yeah.
So at least all previous references will definitely be there. It could give us a start.
True. Right.
Yeah, if the audience has any queries regarding semantic explainability, please go ahead. Raghva, is any of your student and your group is working towards semantic explainability to some extent?
No. I plan to start that now. So I'm trying to hire a PhD student on making or on in the combining ethics and explainability. Right? But no, nothing so far. But okay. Yeah, I plan to start working in that direction.
Okay, thank you. Fine. So it was really, really good because I could find that the participants can get a very fair idea of how they could work with explainable systems and yes, how could they incorporate knowledge graphs to enhance the explainability of the recommendation systems. So at least they can do it now.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present this work. And yeah, hopefully. So, if there are any further questions, you can ask me later on also. So, I gave the link to the lab or the research group, right? So, you can browse through or maybe contact us at some point or any point in time.
What is the full form? KRACR.
Okay, so it's pronounced as cracker.
cracker. Okay.
And this is the full form, right? Knowledgeable Computing and Reasoning Lab. So I reused R twice, but just to get the cracker going.
May I ask how you come across this idea, cracker, of a lab?
So we were discussing some of these possibilities, right? Like I was just playing around with these words, and I asked some ideas from my students as well, and they also suggested a few things. So eventually there's this word puzzle, right? Like you play around with words, and finally this sounded nice. So you can have a cracker, it's easy to pronounce, so that's how we finalized this.
But definitely every letter has some meaning.
yeah right. So I wanted to have Knowledgeable Computing and Reasoning also as part of that lab name. So somehow
we
ended up adding these terms and then came up with the short form.
Good one. So IIITD allows a subdomain.
Yes, it does. You can host, you can create these subdomains.
So thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
It was an enlightenment one.
Sure, yes. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me and giving me an opportunity. And I think the next two sessions are from my PhD students as well. So as Dr. Sarika said, I think most of the day is taken over by us. And they'll be talking about their work related to semantic web technologies, right? So you'll get to know more about semantic web technologies and how they are used in different applications in the next 4 hours. Okay, so with that I'll stop, and hopefully my students are around to take over.
Yeah, thank you so much. So
thank you.
Within next 30-15 minutes, right.